Good morning, folks. It is my pleasure to introduce Professor Wen-mei W, who hails from this great school in the Midwest called the University of Illinois. Professor Wen-mei W made a large number of contributions in the areas of computer architecture and compilers. He holds a Sanders AMD endowed chair at the University of Illinois. If you didn't know this, Mr. Sanders was AMD chair at some point. He also is a member of the famous societies IEEE and ACM, of which he made a fellow. And he has received so many awards that if I was to list them all, he will not have the time to deliver the seminar. So I'll just mention the Morris Wilkes Award and the Bob Rau Awards.
Thank you.
Please.
Hey, thanks, Alex. Is it too loud?
Can you hear me in the back?
Okay, great. So now I'm going to give this talk for probably about 45 minutes, and then I'd love to have questions along the way, and also want to save a little bit of time for discussion. I've been telling all the students that this is perhaps the best time for being a grad student. And when I was a grad student, I felt that I was too late. Okay, all the great work has been done. All the great papers have been published, and it's very, very sad. But today, when I look around, I really feel that there will be some really important work being done. And I'm going to go through the reason why I felt that way. And I was really hoping that the students here will take some notes and do some great work. A few years from now, the future students will say, oh, I was too late. All the great work had been done by this generation here. Okay, so I'm going to talk about some very important revolutionary paradigm shift. And whenever things change, opportunities arise. Okay, many people are afraid of change, but the truth of the matter is, when there's a big change, real opportunities start to arise. And there's also a very big pivot in the industry, so that's causing a lot of movement among the big companies, and you can see all the power struggles and so on across the industry today. And then I'll talk about the cognitive computing systems research, and particularly there are a few things that we have been focusing on at Illinois in the context of these changes. So let me start with the paradigm shift. The biggest paradigm shift that we're seeing today is the application paradigm. In the 1900s, we made incredible progress in terms of how we can measure things. We were able to build our entire semiconductor fabrication process by being able to have finer and finer control and measurement of how we can build those devices. And so, the measurement capability are based on physical instrumentation and some computing capability that goes along with these instruments. And so that we can see farther, we can capture more, and we can communicate better. And if you look at our communication system today, a huge amount of that has to do with how we can handle higher and higher frequency signals along with some computing capabilities in our networks. In the 21st century, we are actually entered into the paradigm where all the things that we do are now being limited by compute. The kind of things that we can do in compute determines what we can do in many of these fields. And here, I'm going to give a few examples. There are many, many examples, but I'm going to give a few of them. First one, semiconductor manufacturing. Instead of going into finer and finer light wavelengths, we are running out of the wavelengths for us to be able to do the patterns. So if you look at all the advanced manufacturing plants, including the one that Intel just announced at White House, the mask have nothing to do with, if you look at the mask patterns, they don't look anywhere close to the devices that they're supposed to form. They are actually computationally generated so that when the light goes through the mask And in between the mask and the semiconductor surface that they're supposed to form these devices, the lights will interfere with each other. And when they hit the surface, they will form these perfect patterns, okay, based on interference. And that is a computational process that someone has spent months of time to generate those kind of patterns. If we look at biology, there's a very big breakthrough recently, and we used to use X-ray-based crystallography to, you know, to essentially kill the living cells, freeze them so that we can observe them. The problem is, once you you observe them, they're dead. Okay, so you cannot see them in action. So you know, in the 21st century, the biggest breakthroughs are based on computational microscope. Essentially, they use X-ray-based the observation as initial condition, and they actually build entire living mechanisms, viruses, cells, in the computational model and molecular dynamic model, and they simulate these things. And we are now in the stage where people are doing experiments based on molecular dynamic simulation, because there's no other way we can do those experiments and observe, you know, what's going on. And you know what, when we look at medical imaging domain, the medical imaging was getting better and better with MRI, with ultrasound, and so on. That many of you probably have experience with MRI, and I'm sorry about that. Because if you have MRI experience, chances are you probably had a sports injury or something, right? So, but if you look at what's going on in the medical field, the best medical imaging capabilities today are metabolic imaging. They actually can observe the cell, the disease development, even before any of the cells start to have real physical change. And they observe the chemical shifts in the cell and predict the disease treatment and development. One of the most recent discoveries that NSF, National Science Foundation, celebrated not too long ago was the discovery of the gravitational wave that Einstein predicted. And they were able to observe that from the LIGO telescope. And this is actually purely based on computation. Essentially what they did was they simulated the relativity model and then generated the patterns that is supposed to happen. And then they used machine learned model to observe the signals from LIGO, and they actually was able to confirm the existence of gravitational wave. So teleconference versus teleimmersion, augmented reality. And the last one will affect many of us. In the 20th century, one of the best inventions is GPS. When U.S. government demilitarized GPS and made them available to consumers, saved many, many marriages. Okay, when people get lost, marriages get broken, right? So on the other hand, when we had GPS, we no longer need to stop at the gas station and ask and decide who to go out and ask at the gas station. But in 21st century, we are now in the self-driving cars. Okay, we are at the point where the computation in these self-driving cars are getting to the point where they can be safer than human. There are still many pitfalls, but I have been working with quite a few companies on their recent progress. And these computation methods are way beyond what we used to think about these systems. So, what is powering this kind of paradigm shift? A very simple way of answering that question is computing finally grew up. Okay, we actually have computing for many, many years, since the since the 1940s. And the computing system has been essentially increasing in its capability, in size, in its execution rate, at phenomenal rate. So when I look at the computing capability today compared to when I was a grad student, the capability has improved by more than a million times. however we measure it, capacity, execution rate, and so on. So here is a quick example of why these things start to happen in the society level and so on. So when we look at the size of the machines, the size of the machine oftentimes determines the amount of DRAM that you have available. And that also determines the size of the model that you can hold. So for example, the Blue Waters machine in Illinois, which is the leadership machine that National Science Foundation funds, it was a $188 million acquisition. And I'm one of the co-PIs, and it's about 2 miles away from my office, and it keeps me warm in the summer. And so it has 1.5 petabytes of DRAM in the system. And the next machine, the sister machine, which is a better known Titan system in the Oak Ridge National Lab, even though its peak performance is higher than Blue Waters because more GPUs, and that's a different story, the memory available in that Titan machine is only half a petabyte. And there are several computational molecular dynamic experiments that people are running on Blue Waters could not be run anywhere else because they needed to have that model fit into the DRAM. Why do they need the model? It's a very simple calculation. In order to get accurate experimental data, the biologists need to have half an angstrom spacing between the grid points that they model or less. Okay, they have the grid points have to be close to each other in order to get accurate physics measure mathematical properties. And if you divide up the typical physicals, the volume that they need to experiment with, a drop of a solvent is easily at the centimeter level. And if you calculate the number of grid points involved in that little drop of solvent, you know why we need so much memory, holding the model, holding the grid points, and do the simulation. The other side of the story is how fast each node is, because the speed at which the node can make progress determines the rate of progress in terms of moving the simulation model forward in time. It doesn't matter how big your system is, if your nodes are not strong enough, you won't be able to move the simulation model in terms of time steps quickly enough. And these time steps need to be at the femtosecond level in order to have convergence. If the time steps are too big, you're going to be deviating from the physical reality and your simulation results will not be correct. And if they're too small, the time step is too fine, then it takes a huge number of time steps to be able to get to the millisecond level chemical reaction that these people are trying to observe. So if you divide up the experimental model time by the time step, you see that there's a huge number of time steps in the order of peta time steps in order to be able to do the work, to do this the experiment. And that is limited by individual node execution rate. This is the reason why GPUs are used so much in the science field today, because that's how we can get faster execution rate on the node level. So what are the types of applications that are demanding the computation power today? Okay. And I have been working with both the science domain and the commercial domain. And this is actually what we observed in the past 5 years. And it was building up, it's becoming more and more clear that these are the kind of applications that are really, really beginning to reap the value of computing. The first kind is what we call the first principle-based models. And these are the kind of methods that have been around for a long, long time. And for those of you who have worked with them, when I was an undergraduate student, that was when Apple II started to come out. I don't know how many of you even know about Apple II. And it uses a microprocessor called 6502. And that processor has 48K address space. So you have 48,000 locations that you can work with for both your code and your data. And so you know what, we felt that that processor was marvelous compared to, you know, the Z80 that we used to work with, right? So you know, it was really, really a great machine. But you know, in order for people to be able to do some of the work with these kind of processors, the small amount of memory, the low execution throughput, they had to simplify the models. So that's why digital signal processing and you know, many of the medical imaging you know, algorithms that people use, ultrasound, you know, your first picture, that will be the first picture that many of you ever had, okay? That's, you know, the ultrasound scan, you know, when your mother is you know, expecting you. And all your first pictures have a huge number of speckles in those pictures. And for those of you who ever look at ultrasound pictures for babies, the first thing you notice is that there's just so many speckles in that picture. The reason is when they reconstruct the ultrasound, they assume that all the sound waves only bounce once in the object. And that's inaccurate. So that's why when you have multiple bounces, they all show up as speckles in your picture. And it doesn't have to be like that. But the acquisition of the signal and the, you know, the reconstruction process are simplified so that they can fit into a low cost, you know, low performance computing system. And that gives you the quality. Turns out that if you use something like distorted Bohr method, you can have much, much higher quality ultrasound pictures. So my prediction is, by the time you have your children and your grandchildren, their pictures will be much better than the picture that you have, okay? Simply because you know, there is going to be one or two generations of ultrasound systems that will be assuming much, much better compute devices, and they're going to be adopting these much better models. So these are the things, you know, applications that are beginning to get out of the traditional assumption it's too expensive. Okay, many of these methods were considered too expensive in the past, but now with the new computing devices, suddenly these methods are well within the reach or well within the capability of our devices today. The second one is actually interesting. The second one is even more, I would say, profound. There are many things that we did not do how to, that did not know how to program. There are many things that we can do very naturally, but we cannot program or teach a computer system to do in the past 30 years. And things like computer vision, natural language, dialogues, stock trading, and fraud detection. Even to this day, most of the credit card companies are still using fraud detection rules that are just not right. Okay, I talk to the credit company every time I travel because they cannot predict my travel patterns. Okay, and you know, every time I travel, now I can predict when their fraud detection is going to be triggered. So I call them ahead of time every time I predict, and I was right. Okay, so you know, so that's how bad some of these, you know, the algorithms are, and we're beginning to see a whole generation of revolution in terms of how people approach these problems. So let's start with computer vision. Computer vision is a field that many of my colleagues spent decades working on, you know, the computer vision. And the traditional way is for grad students, not unlike, you know, a lot of you in this room, we chain them down in their seats and then get them to produce what we call the features. Okay, so the, you know, essentially these are the kind of patterns that you will be, you know, expecting whenever the picture or the video contain the objects of your interest. And so there is a you know, challenge called the ImageNet challenge, you know, that started in the early 2000. And then you know, every year all these computer vision groups will come and you know, take their grad students' crafted features and so on, and then, you know, compete and detect events in the images. So you know, if we look at the history, in 2010, for example, the dots that we have here indicates the accuracy of the of the computer vision system that these teams brought in. So you can see that the top team was getting about 72% accuracy, and the bottom team is getting, I would say, somewhat around 20% accuracy. And obviously, some of these grad students are very sad. Okay, and you prepare for a whole year, you go to the competition, and then they tell you that your software is only 20% accurate. It's just not a very good thing. In 2012, the Toronto team, came in with a very different approach. They used a neural net, and they used GPUs to train the neural net with about 2 million images. And these are the images that many people did not realize that you can train with so many images, because most people did not use the GPUs. And it was actually an interesting story, because David Kirk and I created a GPU programming class in 2007. And then in 2010, Professor Andreas Machonis called me and said, hey, there's this nice course that you and David Kirk are teaching, so I'd like to use your slides and so on. I want to teach an experimental course in Toronto. I said, Andreas, of course. So he took the slides, and then he offered that course. And turns out that there are a bunch of grad students in that class, from this particular group. And one of them is named Alex. So they created the AlexNet with the GPU. And then 2 years later, they were able to use that GPU implementation to crack through 2 million images. So that's, in my mind, that's one of the best course projects that ever came out of these courses. Okay, so don't underestimate what you can do as a grad student. As a grad student, you can change the world. Okay, it's not guaranteed. Okay, but if you do a good work, and you apply it to some important hard problem, you could change the world. Okay, so that's the kind of stuff that we're talking about. And I work with quite a few of these investment and trading companies. And all of them used to hire these finance majors. And they're doing these trading algorithms. So I don't know how familiar you are with these trading systems. But usually they have these candidate trading systems in training. And then they have they do the kind of they keep simulating how these trading systems work, and then they switch. Okay, they will pick the most promising ones into the real decisions. These things used to be crafted by finance majors and implemented by some of the computer science people, and they are paid $500,000 each every year. So if you look at the industry today, they will have about several dozens of machine-trained trading algorithms. Okay, these are not crafted by humans. They're actually crafted through data training. And these candidate algorithms are automatically selected through machine training into the real trading process. So essentially, now they hire only computer science, computer engineering students. They no longer hire financing students anymore. So good for us, but it's kind of bad for some of our financing friends. When I look at all these applications, this is actually this is a representative picture of the current use of deep learning, machine learning in industry today. And so you have some kind of input, in this case is image, and then you have a neural net, okay, that essentially was trained somehow. And when you put the image into the neural net, it will come up with a conclusion, say, okay, here's an object, and it's a stapler. And this appears to be a combinational logic design problem. Basically, you have input, and then you have a logic implementation, and outcome, some kind of answer. So all of this will learn about logic design. you know, it's just bits, right? You have bits on the left-hand side. These are pixel bits. And you feed into that combinational logic. And here comes the answer, which is the NOR gate output, right? So if we think about it, we say, OK, you know, there should be a systematic way of, you know, dealing with this kind of problem, which is exactly right. Because you know what, here is a, you know, a very, very simple example where we have 3 bits input, okay, 3 bits. And then, you know what, we design a piece of logic to do something. And for 3 bits input, we can have 8 input patterns. So we can define for each input pattern what this piece of logic is supposed to do. So that's truth table. And then we synthesize the logic, and we only need to have 4 gates, and we can, you know, essentially do an AND or logic, and then completely, completely satisfy the functionality of this particular design. And for those of you who have done logic design, Alex used to, you know, the work on the Cedar hardware, you know, in the 1980s in Illinois, and you know, he and I used to complain about some of these things all the time, and cry on each other's shoulder. And you know what? This piece of logic is looking for odd number of 1 bits, which is also the definition of exclusive OR, right? So you know, so this is a exclusive OR logic. So sometimes we don't have a complete specification. Somehow we don't know in detail what we should do for each bit pattern. We just know that we are trying to look for, let's say, a number of bits, but we don't know exactly, you know, how to specify that. So we can learn, okay? If we have enough data and we poke at, you know, someone's logic, let's say, you know, if someone in Russia designed a piece of logic, we don't know exactly how they did it. And we say, okay, these are smart guys, so we're gonna learn from them. We're gonna just poke at it with all these bits, okay? And then here out comes the output. So we make these observations. We say, oh, 3 zeros, we get 0. And, you know, 0, 1, 1, we get 0. And then 1, 0, 0, we get 1, and then 1, 1, 0, we get 0. So if we make all these observations, we can reverse engineer, you know, what is in there. So this is essentially what we're doing with human, okay, today. We have this human, you know, who look at the data, right? Look at the data and then tell us what that data has. So essentially each one is one of these observations. We don't know how human brain is designed. We don't know the details, but we're trying to reverse engineer by making those observations. And then if we have enough of this observation data, if we cover all the truth table, then we can actually synthesize that truth table and therefore synthesize the logic. So that's a plausible approach until you look at some of the reality. So here is a simple neural net, Linet, that was, you know, the design a long, long time ago in the 1980s, and it was designed for handwriting recognition. And this neural net is a fairly simple 5-stage network. It has convolution layer. It has subsampling layer, and then it has all connected layers. So you can treat this whole thing as a combinational logic. Absolutely, you can try to treat it that way. The only problem is that this is a very small image that you're feeding into this neural net by any standard. The input is a 32-bit pixel by 32-pixel input, okay? And each pixel is 1 byte, okay? Just, you know, essentially a grayscale input. So essentially we have 1024, 32 times 32, 1024 pixels, and each pixel is 8 bits. So those are the bits that you're feeding into the combinational logic, okay? And these bits essentially will have a truth table of 2^8196 power, okay? And they said, how big is that? Let me give you a little bit of sense. 1 million is right around 2^20, right? 1 million is about 2^20. So if you divide this number by a million, essentially you will subtract 20 out of the power exponent. So you will lower the power from 8,196 to the 8,176. And it's nearly unchanged, okay? So that's why when we use a million training data, okay, a million training data to try to figure out the truth table, okay, the truth table, real truth table of this logic, we are essentially covering 0% of the possible inputs. So this is the reason why we cannot use a brute force approach to use truth table and hope to be able to learn enough about this operation. So what we do is we use convolution and subsampling to aggressively crack down the degree of freedom, okay, so that we can in the end have, you know, use the truth table at some point, which is the last layer, okay, and that's what it is. So this should give you a sense of how difficult, you know, some of these machine learning based, you know, the neural net based approach can really be when it comes to understanding how good the coverage the training data is, okay? And, you know, even though people will tell you, oh, I train with millions and millions of labeled input, in reality, they cover less than any kind of significant digit of the design space. So that's why there's so much trick, so much black art involved in training these deep neural nets, and so many experimentation that are needed, and so many tricks in terms of how you massage your training data, so on, to get you good result. That's where a lot of the industry resources are being spent today, for fundamentally because of this. Okay, so let's go into the kind of the industry state today. Turns out that you know, the adoption of these full cognitive business applications has really exploded since this. In 2011, IBM did something really, really interesting. IBM you know, participated in the Jeopardy competition. And in that showdown, you know, Watson actually won. IBM cheated a little bit, okay? IBM did not use the speech interface because the speech interface was not good enough back then. IBM had to use the interface for the speech challenge participants. So essentially, they use a text interface. So, you know, there are a few things that, you know, they had to kind of declare disability in order to participate in the competition. But in the end, they actually was able to, you know, to beat the champion at that point. And that's why people started to realize that these systems are real. These systems are no longer just, you know, dismissible toys. What did IBM use in the back? And this is something that many people did not pay enough attention. In 2011, the IBM Watson system had 90 of the IBM Power 7 series servers and 2,880 cores. And so, you know, essentially they have a 500 gigabyte per second, you know, on-chip bandwidth. And, you know, you have 20 terabytes of disk, you know, clustered for bandwidth. And it can operate at 80 teraflops. And this machine had to execute the workflow up there, crafted by about close to about 100 engineers total. And, you know, the workflow generated all kinds of potential interpretations of the you know, of the question with what we call the entity assignment, you know, kind of algorithms. And then they actually go into the various possible interpretation and possible answers to, you know, to come up with hypothetical solutions. And each question will typically end up with thousands of these hypothetical solutions. And they have these, you know, statistical methods to be able to, you know, evaluate the confidence level, and then eventually they sort them, and then they say, okay, here's the answer. And that needs to happen in 3 seconds, because that's the point where most of the humans will, you know, will be able to answer. So there's a deadline of 3 seconds. And, you know, when we look back and say, you know, in today's system, we can operate easily with a simple box, a box of 8 GPU machines, okay? And then if you can buy them today in the market, a fairly small box with 8 GPUs in there, and you will have more than 80 teraflops, okay? You have more than 80 teraflops, and you'll have even more bandwidth available in those boxes because of NVLink and so on. So we have improved our technology by about 2 orders of magnitude since the Watson computation, okay, about 2 orders of magnitude. But the interesting part is that if, when we execute some of these, you know, algorithms, we don't get 100 times improvement. The reality is many of these applications are still running roughly at the same speed as this particular kind of system. The reason is, even though these systems that we have today are designed with so much more bandwidth, the bandwidth is actually all centered in the GPU, in the GPU internals. And whenever your data is not reused enough, you will, your execution rate will drop like crazy. So you can actually, you know, see that some of the, these aspects of this workflow will execute at less than 1% efficiency of these hardware devices. So this is part of the reason why we started this Illinois IBM Center. And it was launched in September 2016 last year. And we have quite a few faculty on top, and then a lot of students in the various areas, application, programming tools, and hardware architecture. And we're trying to crack this problem. And we're beginning to see that people are, you know, interested in applications like this. Now, many of you are, you know, probably wondering, you know, in fact, one of the most frequently asked questions is, you know, if we have AI applications, we're going to displace a lot of workers. Okay, we're going to displace a lot of workers. What's going to happen to them? That's a very valid question. But there's another part of the whole thing. That is, if we have a lot of these AI applications, can we begin to do things that we currently just cannot do? And can we do things so that we can actually begin to educate our next generation in a way that we can never achieve in our generation? So this is one of those grand challenges that the center is using as a driving application. So this is called CELA. It's for personalized education. And it has several, you know, deep learning-based components, but you know, it also has a lot of the traditional database and constraint solver-based, you know, technologies. Because when you put together an application like this, you really cannot just use some of these computational logic, you know, kind of approach. There's just many other constraints that we need to be able to deal with. So, you know, this system would ingest the STEM curriculum textbooks and so on. And this leverages a lot of the Watson technology that, currently exists. I'm going to show you a little bit more. And then, you know, we have the web and text scraping, you know, capability to bring in all the, let's say, science projects or math, you know, the exercise problems and so on from the websites. And we have learners pass test results, and we have a machine learning based approach to predict what needs, you know, what would be the next interesting, engaging, you know, learning experience for the learner. And then, you know, we have, you know, these cameras that would determine, you know, what are the available, you know, material for science projects or for various, you know, experiments. And on the other side, you know, what we have a dialogue system with the, you know, the real student. And this dialogue system is currently based on the Watson technology from IBM. And, you know, they actually have, you know, three languages that are extremely well supported, and then some additional new languages being built. And so, you know, we have this dialogue with the learner, and you know, so it's an interview process, and also it's an advising process. So it's really an interactive, you know, conversational process to guide the students through any kind of experiential learning. And so, in order to make this work, we also have to have very high-end video observation and video understanding technology. So, just to give you a sense of, you know, how much you know, computing that you know, we need to do, the science concepts that we use in the system is based on the next generation science standard. So if you go to their website, you will see that you know, there are all these curated you know, information for teachers and educators. So these are natural language, you know, the description of what the students are expected to know and their expected proficiency at each grade level. So we actually go to these websites, and we scrape the website, we take the PDF, and we take some of this HTML, you know, input, and we actually build concept graphs. And you know, these are, you know, very, very large graphs, and the graph databases, and the various key-value pair. So this is actually a very representative modality of what we call the cognitive application. Essentially, we're taking quote-unquote unstructured data, the data that were designed for human consumption, not previously for computer consumption, and then build them into a curated database that we can do inferencing. We can actually use some of this information as the basis for synthesizing that interview question and so on. So you know, these are the information that we extract from the various blocks of this, you know. And the rules for extracting information is actually machine learning too. So this kind of, you know, there are all these kind of levels of machine learning that we're doing in order to even make one of the components to work. So this tells you, you know, how sophisticated some of these systems need to be. So, you know what, basically, through this process, it has become very clear. And it also has become has been very clear for many of the industry people who are really involved in the developing of these applications. The traditional programming approaches really fail to develop these applications. The traditional approach is that you think about algorithms, you think about, you know, what are the what's the input pattern and so on. The reason why these approaches fail is precisely because those approaches implicitly assume structured data representation. And these kind of applications need to deal with data that were not originally designed in a painstaking way to be consumed by the computers. So with the wide adoption of this machine learning and deep learning kind of things, the core development has actually shifted from algorithms and data structures and building functions, building objects, and building layers and layers of APIs into experimentation. Okay. And you know what, so into how you can actually, you know, I would say pre-process data into the form that that neural nets can actually, you know, give you good results. How do you control the noise that were introduced in that process? And so therefore, the experimentation with a large amount of data is on the critical path of application development. This is the reason why whenever you have any team that is going to any of these big competition today, they will all tell you the team that can use the biggest amount of GPUs today tend to win, okay? Because they can do a lot more experimentation than the smaller teams. And this is becoming the norm of software development. In the old days, when you have a software development team, you tend not to need to have a lot of computing resources. You're just editing your code and so on. And then the verification team, the testing team, require a lot of resource just to test all the software. But now we have this, you know, cycle of experimentation and development, and there's no way to do a high quality software without a very large amount of hardware resources, even in the development stage. So I'm going to try to wrap up very quickly. So here are just a few things that we're doing in the research. You know, one is what we call the cognitive application builder. Remember, we have hundreds of IBM engineers developing that Watson system. And through that process, they learn a lot of challenges in terms of how to put together this kind of system and why it takes so many people and so much time to be able to build an application like this. So CAP is an environment to help people to build these applications much faster with much better results. So let me give you one example here. Most of the developers would like to build these applications as services. Okay, so you have, for Sila, in order to be able to observe the student and come up with some kind of, friendly and useful comments in the end and say, you're not doing it quite right. Okay, and there is actually several important pieces of services that need to happen in between the video stream and the final kind of the conversation that you can have with the student. You need to do video processing, and then you need to correlate the video processing with the steps, okay, the steps that the student is supposed to be doing, which is machine learned. And then you also need to have an inference engine to take the learner's background model and the STEM concept projects that I just talked about, and compare that with the correlated results, and synthesize the dialogue, question and answer and so on. You don't ask a question without knowing the answer, right? So, that whole process tend to be a pipeline or some kind of graph of services. So this is what the user tend to write. If you execute this this process on a system today, you get terrible performance. You get really, really bad performance. Part of the reason is that these things are serialized and they become very, very slow because one needs to wait until the next to finish. There's very little overlap and there's not good utilization of system resources. So this is the implementation we actually generate out of the CAP tool. So we take the video processing and we realize that when you correlate, you don't have to correlate with the with the most recent video processing. You can take several previous frames, okay, and so that you can do the correlation in parallel with the video processing. So you can be processing some next frames, and meanwhile the correlation can happen for the previous one. For those of you who design pipelines, this is just process of pipeline design. But it turns out that for traditional software development environment, this is extremely hard to do in legacy software. So this is the reason why I have been so excited about this new era, because I work with national labs and many of these industry companies on recompiling their legacy code for the various physics models and various commercial applications in my previous research lab life. And it was hard. The legacy problem is really, really hard. But here, we have an opportunity to determine our own fate. We are helping the industry to build the next generation legacy code. So what you guys are going to see when you become industry practitioners and professors and so on, if the legacy code that you see are bad, it's on us. Okay, so we would take responsibility, okay? So, quick comment about the hardware. The hardware that we're using in the center is fairly state of the art. We have these Minsky machines, and by the way, you can buy them, you cannot get them because they're back ordered in the market. These things are selling like hotcakes today. And so the Minsky machines, each has 4 Pascal GPUs connected with NVLink. The NVLink bandwidth is right around 70 gigabytes per second. And the standard PCIe connection is 8 gigabytes per second. So we're talking about 10 times, okay? And that is a good step towards what I call the democratization of bandwidth in the system. When you look at the compute unit inside the GPU today, the compute unit to the top level of memory hierarchy on chip is multiple terabytes per second bandwidth, okay? And then when you go to the interface to what we call the stack memory, the most advanced memory technology, then we are talking about somewhere around 700 gigabytes per second. And then we go to the traditional memory bandwidth, the memory, you know, the technology, then we're talking about somewhere around 200 gigabytes per second. And then we go to the PCIe, we're talking about 8 gigabytes per second. And this is what I call the gravitational effect. The real application performance tend to be limited by the weakest link in your system. And that's when we start to have very low utilization of some of these things. So NVLink is definitely a very good first step, but our real price is actually going to be the next step, which is what I'm showing in the bottom of the paragraph, where we're dispersing the compute capabilities into the memory banks, into the network channels, into the storage controllers. But the programming of these things is extremely hard because we're talking about additional layers of compute hierarchy, and most people cannot handle that. You know, the real programmers have not been able to handle more than just a couple levels of the hierarchy. So that's the reason why the tools are so important. So we have, you know, this workload acceleration kind of work. And for example, matrix factoring, you know, for those of you who don't like linear algebra, give it up, okay? Just go and take a class. You know, if you have not taken linear algebra, just go and do it, okay? Don't complain, do it. The reason is there's so many things that you will not be able to understand in the application if you didn't have a good linear algebra. And so matrix factorization is one of the most used linear algebra the computation in our system. And we collaborate with the IBM team on how we can factor the matrix in the most numerically stable and fast way. So the GPU version of this library is now being worked into the CU matrix factor library because it's used so much in industry as well. So we're working with NVIDIA to, you know, to make that available to their user base into the frameworks. So let me conclude. I don't want to just conclude. I want to kind of also give you something to, you know, to take away. So applications have a very large appetite for more computing power. And do not confuse the peak performance of the chips or the systems that these manufacturers sell you as computing power. Much of that may not be realizable. Okay. In Blue Waters today, when we look at all the science teams, across all the science teams, the average utilization of the processor chips is less than 10% of the peak. Okay. The applications are running less than 10% of the peak of the hardware. And most of that is because of the lack of, you know, available strong links in the I/O level, and you know, the lack of computing capability in some of these, you know, low, sort of the deeper level of the hierarchy. And the second one is heterogeneous geneity has become the norm of all the hardware systems. For scientific computing, we're seeing on Blue Waters 2 to 3 times faster experiments using GPU nodes than the non-GPU nodes. Why is this significant? It turns out that when you think about these things, the Blue Water cost for the 5 years is $188 million plus $22 million of operational costs per year. If you take all that and think about the science teams, and if you have 2 to 3 times, you're magnifying the machine by 2 to 3 times. So you're actually magnifying the machine value from $288 million to about 2 to 3 times. And that's a very, very powerful, I would say, resource magnification for our taxpayers. Okay? And this is the reason why the next generation high-performance hardware all use, you know, some sort of GPUs in there. And then I want you to, you know, to really think about some of the cognitive computing kind of things. You know, but think about game-changing applications. Don't just think, always think about figuring out the difference between apples and oranges or cats and dogs and so on. Now, those are fun examples, but you really need to think about how these applications are going to truly make the lives of our future generations better. Customized education, better engagement of application, better medical diagnosis that we just cannot do today. There are so many things that can be better done by the machine simply because the machine can suffer. The machine can suffer a lot more than human beings. Okay, so we put them into good use to complement our human capabilities. The next generation heterogeneous systems, our estimate is that if we succeed in democratizing compute and bandwidth, we can improve the real application performance by about 100 times from now until 5 years from now. And that 100 times is going to allow us to do several interesting things. If things are taking minutes, they become real time. That's a very big advantage. If things take weeks to happen, they can take now hours to happen. Then the experimentation can be done in real iteration. So those are the kind of things that we will need to be able to provide to our next generation to be able to make real progress. And high productivity development with software synthesis. We are at the point where we're running out of capable people who can actually develop these applications and improve these applications. So we would need to, you know, improve the productivity of people. So, you know, with this, I would like to encourage you to, you know, to think about your thesis research and think about all your, you know, learning, and hopefully, you know, this will add to some of your future plans. For example, take a linear algebra class. Okay, thank you.
We have time for a few questions.
Someone must have prepared one question. Let me start with a question. How many of you are grad students? Okay, this is October. Excellent. Okay, who's going to ask the second question?
Okay, I'll ask the second question.
All right.
If nobody else wants to. So you pointed out the size of the search space, so to speak. You do the 8K and so on.
Yeah.
And, you know, even with the successful neural networks, it still takes enormous amounts of time to train them.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So do you think there is some other magic beyond convolution and...
Yeah. Absolutely. You know what, there is a very active area called the sort of the joint neural net and physics model approach. So this is used in a self-driving car a lot. So what happens is that you know, if you look at the input into the self-driving car process, you know, there are certain inputs that are just physically impossible. Okay, so but the system doesn't know that just from the learning point of view. So there is a an approach where people use the physics principles to identify, to narrow down the, you know, the desired physical space. And also to verify if the current collection of you know, training data actually covers sufficiently the plausible input, right? But the possible input, and that physical you know, kind of model was actually used quite a bit in the aviational control systems. So basically, what they do is, I just flew in yesterday, and I, you know, every time I talk to my aviation colleagues, I would try to cancel my trips, right? It's always very scary when you talk to these people about the crashes and so on. So if you look at the aviation system, it's an incredibly difficult process to verify. But in the end, what they do is they impose these safety rules, right? The separation, the rule of separation, so that they can apply some physical laws. If you are always out of each other's way for at least 200 some meter, whatever, then the physics rule would give you several seconds before you can collide, right? So those are the kind of things that will be imposed into the self-driving car, design, so that some of the inputs will become quote unquote impossible, and you have to enforce that. So those are the kind of things that people are doing to be able to control the process. Yes.
So the kind of problems you're dealing with deep learning here and these enormous amounts of data are the kind of problems where the answer is kind of fuzzy and ill-defined, and that's why explicit algorithmic approaches, having programmers trying to figure out what letter is in the vision, works.
Yeah.
But at the other end, there are still problems that have very precise, correct answers, such as the physics simulations, the molecular dynamic simulations that some scientists are doing,
yes,
where the laws are very precise. And I think probably a machine learning approach there would be less effective just because it gives fuzzy answers. What do you see as the boundary between those two, where there could be some kind of synergy between the two?
In the end, these two have to be combined at some point. They have to work together. And currently, most people don't actually do it. For example, if you look at the medical imaging domain, and there's a lot of interest in using machine learning-based approach to do some of the radiology review and so on to get additional accuracy of this. And for example, another example is for surgery, for a computer-aided surgery. What happens is, I don't know how many of you have seen real surgery, and it's kind of really a little scary. You have these people cutting, and then the blood is all over the place, and it's for these doctors to figure out whether they truly got a tumor, in that process is extremely hard, right? So going back to that point, if you look at the most advanced surgery, computer-aided surgery, they use a lot of machine learning, a lot of the deep learning kind of things, but they also use multimodality sensors to be able to see past, let's say the blood and so on. They use ultrasound and so on. So those are the kind of things that give you the modalities give you additional ways to screen away some of the uncertainties, right? And that's really how people are using some of the physics, the physics knowledge to be able to constrain.
But I guess the air traffic control example you gave is another example. If airplanes are more than a certain distance apart, it's physically impossible for them to collide.
So for the next few images, there are only certain subsets of the image that needs to be in the training data. Exactly. So these are the kind of things that eventually has to happen. Otherwise, this is an unsolvable problem, to be honest.
I guess another answer to Wayne's question is that the convergence has to happen because the hardware is the same. We're running on the same hardware.
Exactly.
High-performance hardware.
Yes. Yeah. So that's exactly right. We don't have secret sauce hardware for this kind of stuff. They're the same things. Exactly.
All right. Let me tell you the secret word for those of you who want to know and have been waiting long. It's Urbana-Champaign. And if you don't know what that is, go look up where University of Illinois is located.
And you know, so Alex, you know, the Alex can also tell you, you know, the winter experience. So the, you know, I really thank Alex for inviting me. On a February day, I was able to sit outside in a little cafe. We're chatting about the good old days when both Alex and I were shivering when we walked between buildings in February. So thank you very much for giving me the opportunity. Thank you.